Good afternoon. I'm Michael Markowitz. I'm director of the IRP, a program that has flourished at the New School for more than 50 years. It has provided retirees and those facing retirement with opportunities to explore and be part of a team of scholars. We encourage you to come forward at the end of this session and leave me your name and address, and we will invite you to an information session where we promise you you'll think differently about education than you have in the past. We're taping this program today, so if you have to leave for any reasons, please try to use the outside aisles rather than come down the center aisle, which is designed to make you look unflattering. No cell phones. And now let me turn the floor over to my colleague, Ken Witte, who is part of the team of Fridays at One program, and he is going to introduce today's speaker. Again, thank you for coming.
Thank you, Michael. So I'm the new co-chairman of Fridays at One, and this is my launch. So it's my pleasure to introduce Suzanne Braun Levine. She's a writer, editor, and nationally recognized authority on women, families, and changing gender roles. She was the first editor of Ms. Magazine from 1972 to 1988. She was the first woman editor of the Columbia Journal. She's written several books on life after 50, a series about women in what she calls second adulthood. Everyone here knows about that. And the series began with her popular book, Inventing the Rest of Our Lives. She regularly reports on the ongoing changes in women's lives and lately on men's lives as they affect women. And she's been on national media, interviews, lectures, and frequent blogs. She also happens to be a lifelong friend of mine and classmate. We met in sixth grade. I give you Suzanne Braun Levine.
Thank you. Wonderful to be here. It took me about 50 years to stop calling Ken Kenny. That's the leftover. But then he stopped calling me Susie, so it was fair enough. My topic today is how Ms. Magazine changed the world. But the subtext is also how Ms. Magazine changed my life, because I had the great joy of working with material that wasn't just interesting, but it was life-changing. So that every time there was an article that I was editing, my consciousness changed. So it was quite an intense experience. Let me just tell you give you some examples of how I changed. First day at work, I went in a pink silk blouse, a pink cashmere skirt, and a girdle. And I walked in, there were three little offices. There were two of those big old library desks with one leg missing. People were sitting on orange crates. It was clearly I wasn't dressed for the job. And I figured that out pretty soon. But to show you the kind of yin and yang that went on, a few days later, when I was dressed more appropriately for the work, I was in the elevator, and a man turned around, red-faced, and he said, "How dare you dress in pants in the middle of the city as a working person? You are denigrating all working women." So that's the way it went, you know, revelation and then conflict. So I was no longer in Kansas, that was for sure. But where I was in many ways I had come home to where I was, as a woman, understood, where I was able to tell the truth. And that becomes the mantra, I think, of the whole women's movement, which is telling the truth about our lives. And for me, there was a very specific experience. The preview issue of the magazine, which you may remember, it's in the poster, The Woman with the Many Arms, had in it a spread, and it said, "We have had illegal abortions." And then there were the names of several celebrities, more than several, a lot of really brave women, because at the time it was still illegal. And then in the corner there was a little coupon where you could add your name if you had had an illegal abortion. And I looked at that and I thought, yes, I want to tell the truth. I had an illegal abortion. I've never told anybody. But here's an opportunity to share that, because I knew it was a safe place. So I filled out the coupon, sent it in, and by the time they were being, the envelopes were being opened, I got to open my own envelope. So it's what I'm going to try to share with you is the way the personal and the political were continuously interacting. And I guess also it's my first experience with the basic message of Ms. Magazine, which was, if one woman is experiencing something, there's no doubt that there are lots of others who are experiencing the same thing. And the purpose of describing these experiences is to reassure us all that we're not the only one, that we're not crazy, and that we're not wrong. Now, just to give you a little sense of where we were coming from then, you will remember, but you may be surprised. I had just gotten married, which means that I had earned my MRS, and that meant that I couldn't get a bank loan without my husband's signature. I couldn't wear pants in many New York restaurants. I joined the Harvard Club, but I had to go in through a separate entrance and eat in a separate dining room. And I paid the same dues. The ads, the Help Wanted ads in the New York Times were organized Help Wanted Female, Help Wanted Male. Because I loved basketball, this image is very important to me, we had to play half-court basketball because girls didn't, it was assumed we didn't have the stamina. And what's more, if you had your period, you couldn't play at all. And this I just remembered the other day, being female was a reason to be excused from jury duty. So that was my personal context. At the same time, in the larger world, there were almost no women in Congress who weren't the widow of a congressman who had died, until Bella Abzug came along with the slogan, "Woman's place is in the House of Representatives." There were no women news anchors, and everybody was absolutely sure that that would never happen because people would not take seriously a woman's voice. All the players in orchestras were men, except occasionally for the harpist who wore a long gown. That changed overnight when they started doing tryouts behind a curtain. And they were just evaluated based on their musical ability. and Ms., MS, stood for multiple sclerosis. So early issues of the magazine really tried to parse some of these circumstances. And from those early issues, you may remember some of these articles. Click, The Housewife's Moment of Truth, which was built around a story of a woman walking past her husband's socks on the floor. And when he said, why don't you pick them up? And she said, pick them up yourself. And that was a click, and that was a revelation. And she understood then the power imbalance. I Want a Wife, which was another classic about how nice it would be to have somebody to cook and clean for you and to boost your morale and be there when you came home. Then there was a piece on, this was a piece that was a little hard for me. It's funny, a lot of the material that we published was distressing or challenging to me as well as the readers. This was the one about body hair. We ran an article called Welfare is a Woman's Issue. And Gloria Steinem created the slogan, every woman is one man away from welfare. And we wrote about lesbian love and relationships way before other magazines. And soon after, things started to happen very fast. Roe v. Wade, legalizing abortion, came in 1973, the first year of the publication of the magazine. Title IX came in 1973. Title IX is my favorite piece of legislation because I think it changed the experience of being a girl in this country for an entire generation because it opened up sports in colleges. It guaranteed, Title IX guaranteed equal treatment for girls in any federally funded educational institution. And within no time, you saw girls' soccer teams, you saw girls' varsity teams. The football teams didn't like that very much. The alumni of a lot of universities didn't like it very much. But suddenly there were girls experiencing, wanting to win, training to win, coming back if they lost, teamwork, all these things that sports can teach you that you don't learn from jump rope. And in fact, we used to think that running like a girl was a physiological thing. You remember when you run with your feet like that? Not so. No one runs like a girl anymore. I think it had to do with keeping your skirt down. We had the great contest between Billie Jean King and Bobby Riggs, which was the Battle of the Sexes, they called it. She talked about that interesting that event on the radio recently, and she was saying that that was the absolutely scariest moment of her life because she realized that so much depended on her winning, which she did. Our Bodies Ourselves came out before Ms., actually, a year or two before, and it revolutionized not only our understanding of how our bodies worked, but how to deal with the medical establishment. At that point, you went to a doctor who was a revered male. You hoped he would like you so that he would pay attention. And you did what you were told. And every diagnosis was a mystery. And every requirement was unquestioned. So that, for example, in childbirth, The procedure was, you went into the hospital, they knocked you out, they sent your husband down the hall, and you woke up, and it were handed your baby, and then, this is part that's not so bad, you put on your bed jacket, you remember bed jackets, and stayed in the hospital for 5 days. But women's bodies were mysterious, not only to the world, but to ourselves. And our bodies ourselves did an amazing job, and they are still updating and revising and of enabling us to get information. And now I think there's hardly anybody who doesn't double check a medical recommendation on the internet and against their friends. And the term Ms. became more accepted, except by the New York Times, where only after 10 years of picketing did Abe Rosenthal finally concede that people could request to be designated as Ms. in 1986. So although Harry Reasoner predicted that there wouldn't be more than 6 issues worth of material for Ms. Magazine to write about, the stories kept coming. And many of them fell into the category of naming experiences that we were all aware of but had never named. Gloria always said, we just called it life. But in fact, I've come to believe that a lot of the power of a movement is the way in which it defines terms and creates language. So that terms like battered women, sexual harassment on the job, reproductive freedom as a human right, all of the issues of gender-neutral language, chairperson and all of that, and also the excesses of some of these. One of my favorite articles was called The Great Person Hole Cover Debate. And it also was a place where a lot of voices and personalities were discovered for the first time. We were the first to publish Alice Walker. We were the first to write about Meryl Streep. We wrote about Crystal Lee Jordan, who Norma Rae. We had features like populist mechanics, which were ways to help women understand all these mysterious things that only men knew how to do, like change oil. And we had a feature called Lost Women, which was surprising, I think, even to the editors, that there were so many incredibly brave and creative and important women who had been completely lost to history. And now we have women's history. That's another term that never existed before. And so many important pieces of history have been retrieved under the women's studies banner. We wrote about Shirley Chisholm, the first woman to run for president, and we were taken off the newsstand throughout the South. And to this day, I can see that picture, and I think a lot of people can, and every time in yoga class, I go into child's pose, I think of her. That became emblematic of what the war against reproductive rights could do. And the reaction, it began to, I think, as the successes and the material began to accumulate, it became clear to the forces that be that this might be very threatening. And so there began to be a reaction. and a lot of anger. And for example, our ad salespeople were trying to get ads for cars, which everybody thought was a waste of time because, of course, women only bought cars based on their color. And the men chose the brand. And they would make these trips out to Detroit. And on one occasion, they gave a cocktail party for all of the executives in Detroit. And nobody came. They had all colluded that they were going to show these women who was boss. And I was lucky enough to be shielded by being in the office most of the time. But I would often go to a cocktail party or something and really not want to tell people where I worked, because there would always be one guy who'd get that look in his eye, and you knew that he was going to come over and poke at me and go after me on all the things I believed in. And the sport was, could I make the feminist cry? So, but Gloria really got the brunt of the hostility. And I will just give you one example. Do you remember Al Goldstein and Screw magazine? He put on the cover a drawing of a woman with her legs spread and Gloria's head on it. And it was on newsstands all over the city, hanging up, you know. And she has a pretty thick skin, but this one really got to her, and she, you know, it made her uncomfortable walking around the street, and there was nothing you could do. You couldn't take him on, because that's just what he wanted. So she was complaining to her friend Bella Abzug, and saying, Bella, this is so awful. That's my vagina up there. And Bella said, so? Those are my labia. And that kind of, Bella epitomized the way you get through the heat. She had a big mouth, but you needed a big mouth. And she just plowed ahead. And she had that earthy thing. Then it was over. Gloria was moved on. But that ability to laugh got a lot of women through a lot of stuff. And in fact, it was very important to the content of the magazine. We ran an article called, If Men Could Get Pregnant, Abortion Would Be a Sacrament. And how's your sex life? Better, worse, I forget. But really the high point, I think things were moving upward for a very long time. And the high point was in 1977, the Women's Conference in Houston, which assembled 18,000 women delegates who had been elected in every state of the country for the previous year. And 22,000 people were there. And it was a real show of force. I think people didn't know how many of us were out there. Three first ladies were there. Rosalind Carter, Lady Bird Johnson, and Betty Ford. There were amazing people like Barbara Jordan and Margaret Mead. And the delegates represented every conceivable iteration of women's lives, from Native Americans to lesbians to ladies who wore pink silk shirts and pink cashmere skirts. And the leaders represented also the different perspectives of the movement. Bella, who organized it, was a wonderful lesson in how to operate within the system and outside the system. there would be occasions where she would be, when she was in Congress, she'd be in the chamber voting on a bill, and then she would come out and march with the women who were protesting. It made her very effective in terms of legislation. And there was Gloria, who always said, this is a revolution, not a reform, and kept holding out for really dealing with terms and issues like patriarchy. She never wanted to be inside the system. And then there was Betty Friedan, who had really started it all with her identification in the feminine mystique of the problem that has no name, which was the sense of a loneliness and frustration among women who were trapped in their homes. And Betty was trying to hold out for the sort of middle class version of feminism. And as the movement got more radical and as the lesbian voices got louder, she got very concerned about what she called the lavender menace. But in fact, by the time the plank identifying lesbian rights came up in Houston, she came around and voted for it, which was pretty big deal. But Houston was very in your face, and that was when the backlash began to mobilize. We all remember Phyllis Schlafly, who really mobilized armies of women to defeat the ERA. The Hyde Amendment was passed prohibiting abortion, any federal funds to go to any abortion facility, even in foreign countries. You may remember Anita Bryant. Do you remember the spokesperson for Florida Orange Juice? Who went after homosexuals with fiendish venom. Comprehensive child care legislation, which was a really important issue and a great achievement when it passed in Congress, was vetoed by Richard Nixon. And so there began to be days when, as someone said, if you thought you saw the light at the end of the tunnel, you were looking in the wrong direction. So today I think we can look back on lots of progress and look ahead to lots of challenges. Certainly there have been incredible breakthroughs for women in every walk of life and in terms of our sense of ourselves. Yet there's on the one hand, on the other hand, although women have emerged as important scientists and technology experts, in fact, the numbers of women studying science are going down. It seems to be because the culture is still so unreceptive to women. Although we've achieved the unthinkable, which is women in the military, those women are being harassed sexually in ways that nobody ever could have expected. Equal pay started out at 59 cents for every woman to every dollar of every man. It went up to 77 cents and hasn't moved since. In terms of science and health and medical research, we've only just begun to understand the ways in which medically women's bodies react differently from men's bodies. It used to be that they would study men and then reduce the percentage 30% for women and figured that was the way to look at it. And in fact, then when there are now gender studies, medical gender studies, that show things like women experience heart attacks so differently from men that because we think that a heart attack is that pain in your chest and then you fall over, don't go to the doctor. And in fact, for women, the symptoms can be jaw pain, pain in the middle of your back, all of these things that you say, oh, I don't want to bother the doctor with, and that women have to know. And many diseases turn out to affect women differently. We have family leave, very nice, but we are the only industrialized country that doesn't have paid family leave. In fact, the whole setup in terms of equalizing family life and enabling men to experience the domestic part of life as well as women experience the external part of life is crippled by the notion that it's every family for itself, that every family has to solve their problems on their own, and if they can't, it's their fault. Also, there's the assumption that women are caregivers. And just to give you an idea of how profound that assumption is, statistics show that you have a 50% better chance of being cared for in your own home rather than a nursing facility if you have either a daughter or a daughter-in-law. Appearance. We all know this whole idea that you women should look as young as they can, be as thin as they can, and you look in the magazines, really the images of attractive women haven't changed a lot since the 50s, except for one thing, which is strength has become an admired physical attribute. My trainer said to me a couple of years ago, I loved this. She said, you know, my clients are starting to ask for Michelle Obama arms, which is really, that's great. But if you're fat or disabled, you're really shunned. And if you're over 50, you're invisible. And this is something that we're going to really have to work on. One way I think that it's important to work on, and I say this to all of you, is that we are very upfront about our age, because I think women have lied about our age so long that anybody who can get away with looking younger claims that younger age. And that this does a disservice, because instead of, my mother was 95, she looked 75. When she was 75, she looked 50. And she lied about her age appropriately. So that instead of enabling 95-year-old women to look at her and say, gee, that's what 95 looks like, she didn't do herself the service and she didn't do them the service of being open about it. So that's another form of telling the truth. Of course, the issue of abortion rights is heading backwards in the most horrific way. These court cases keep coming up. There's a new one in front of the Supreme Court now. And in fact, in Texas, which has been leading the charge, there were 44 abortion clinics in Texas 2 years ago. Now, Texas and four of its neighboring states have 12. And if this Supreme Court decision goes the wrong way, there'll be even less. So there's an awful lot more for us and our sons and our daughters and our grandchildren to do. But I really do believe that the outrage that emerged with Ms. Magazine and empowered so many women of my generation, that outrage is stronger than ever. Or, as Gloria Steinem puts it, you have to quote her because she could spend her life writing little button slogans. The truth will set you free, but first it will piss you off. Thank you. Thank you.
Marriages and in New Jersey, et cetera, you know, all places like that. Here we are in 2015, and we have Hillary who's running for office. And while women have made advanced strides, there's still the whole center of our country. You know, we're in New York, there's California that accepts this so easily. Do you think, number one, that we are ready for a woman president? And number two, what kind of a candidate do you feel Hillary is to represent us?
It's an interesting question because I think last time out, the country was neither ready for Hillary nor was she ready to be the president. I think now is the moment. She is so authoritative, so competent, so fearless, and she's got guts. She's got amazing guts, and she has leadership. What she doesn't have is a very relaxed style, but neither did Richard Nixon. I mean, we've had plenty of clumsy presidents. And if you just watch her laugh, I think she has the greatest laugh. And that, to me, says that she's got what it takes. I think she's got everything going for her. Yeah.
Thank you for this extraordinary experience of you summarizing so well everything that took place. And congratulate you for everything you accomplished. The thing I'm concerned about, and have always been concerned about in terms of the feminist movement, is that I always felt that women, when they weren't feminists, possibly, were really better than any of the men. And not in terms of how they may have served other people, but in terms of what they might have believed. Namely, when they got into industry, maybe they shouldn't have become the type of executives that men were. When they got into the military, they shouldn't have become the people who wanted to be better than the other men. The problem for me with Hillary is she's trying to show that she's strong enough to be president. I think we need a president that's weak enough to make the country a better thing. And so I'm wondering how you react to those comments.
Well, that's very well put, but I think she has the empathy and the understanding of diplomacy and the ways people can work together.
I'm really talking about the movement, not Hillary, per se. I mean, that's what I'm asking about, what women could represent as opposed to, you know, what men represent.
Women definitely do things differently, and in fact, especially in terms of working collectively. There are a couple of studies which I love, one of which shows that when women are together working on something or having coffee, the hormone oxytocin is released. And that's called the cuddle hormone, but it also makes you feel good. And it is reduces stress. And one of the thoughts about this research is that one of the reasons that women are living longer than men is because we get these regular doses of oxytocin that take the stress levels down. There's another study, which you may have read about, which was done by some women in a science lab, and they began to notice that when something went wrong, the men all charged off into their offices and slammed the door. The women all came out of their offices and made coffee. And they came up with what they called the tend and befriend explanation for that behavior, as distinct from the, when you fight or flight, but welcome to my world. And that it's really very different, because if you're in a tend and befriend mode, you're being much more thoughtful, much more deliberative, whereas if you're in the fight or flight mode, your adrenaline is seething, and you're going to act impulsively and maybe violently. So studies like this do suggest that there are different ways to lead, and that women have a lot to offer in that area.
Could I? I have another study that complements the ones you've point out, and that is when men take care, have the sole care of tiny babies, little babies, their testosterone level goes down significantly.
Don't worry. No, I've seen that one.
Hi, thank you very much. I was a charter subscriber to Ms. Magazine, and several of the things that Ms. started, which you didn't address, which I think are very significant, was the issue of ageism, which particularly affects women. I remember an article called "I'm Not Your Mother," and also the international scope of abuse against women, which I think there were many, many articles on the global suppression of women, and I think that they were one of the first publications to do that.
Yes, absolutely right. And in fact, Ms. Is still being published by the Fund for the Feminist Majority. Ellie Smeal, who was one of the founders of NOW, is the head of that. And they have gone much more intensively into the international issues and are doing a very, very good job.
Many years ago, I remember young women saying, "I'm not a feminist." And these were women who were accomplishing things and didn't relate to the Ms. generation. What do you think, or where do you think we are now with younger women in terms of dealing with some of these issues?
I think we all get impatient that they're not out there demanding the kind of change that we did. Their answer, and I respect it, is that they have their own issues. That yes, abortion is a gigantic issue for all of us, but it's not their primary issue, whether you agree with that or not. And that they have all kinds of gender issues and economic issues and international concerns, and that they are mobilizing online. So that when we say, "Why aren't you out there marching?" they say, "Why aren't you reading our websites?" Where that on one occasion, Walmart apparently put out a T-shirt that had something horrible on it. A bunch of women got online and created a storm, and that T-shirt was out of the store in 48 hours. So they do have the capacity to mobilize. I think they have the spirit. And the only question is, I have a daughter who's 27. She wouldn't dream of compromising her independence. And sometimes, you know, I say to myself, well, maybe I should tell her how bad it was so that she'd, you know, be more armored to hold on to all of the things that we've achieved. But on the other hand, I don't want her to even know how bad it could be, because she's blithely going through life, traveling alone, going to restaurants alone, playing sports. She would never in a million years do what I think all of us did, which was if you had a date with a girlfriend and some guy called, everybody understood, right? Right? She would never, ever do that. So I have great faith in these young women, but I am frustrated too with specifically the abortion issue, how somehow it's getting away from us.
Thank you very much. This has been a wonderful recitation of the ways that most of us remember all too well. And it does my heart good to hear of all the effective action that we've taken over all these years. When you were talking about that ad about who's had an abortion, I was thinking one of the things, I don't know if it's come from young women, I don't think it's come from our generation, but I could be wrong. That has to do with if one in three American women have had abortions, that we need to be talking about it to one another. And I know that made me talk about it to other people. And I think that that's an important thing to make people understand how ubiquitous abortion is and how many lines it crosses and how many religions forbid it and how those particular religions, those women are exercising their choice. So I also was in a women's group around that time that had the first rape speak out. And where we got the courage to do that, to have women stand up and talk about being raped, was because you did that ad. And so I wanted to ask about the sense of shame that you had to combat with that as we did, and to ask, what do you think has happened to women's shame over all these years? Is it lighter? Is it different? Is the group dynamic that you talked about, is that still as powerful in cracking it?
That's interesting. Shame. I mean, certainly shame was one of the most controlling factors in our lives. We were ashamed of how we looked. We were ashamed if people didn't like us. We were ashamed of our bodies. I'm sure that you've all, men and women, had the experience of looking at a picture of yourself when you were a teenager, and you thought you were the ugliest human being on the face of the earth. And you see that picture, and you say, what a good-looking person that is. I mean, it's heartbreaking how much self-respect we didn't avail ourselves of. I do think that women are working together, and that the power of sharing experiences is still there. I think one problem is that we don't get into the same room as much as we used to. The internet is great, but making eye contact, hugging somebody, listening to a voice that's trying to tell you something that they've never said before is very different from, you know, looking at printed words. So I think that there are going to have to be different ways of sharing from ours.
I don't know if you saw the documentary this week on PBS on India's daughter, the poor girl who was raped and killed on a bus, but it was just horrifying to hear the culprits and their lawyers say, you know, she deserved it because she's walking down the street with her date after dark. But it occurs to me that women all over the world really need to educate their sons from the time they're very, very young on how to deal with women. Also, I just want to mention that I used to know a woman in Ireland, and she would get her Ms. magazine subscription, and customs in at the airport in Ireland would tear out the back pages, which had ads for birth control, which of course was illegal, and birth control is illegal in Ireland.
No, I think the magazine for a lot of people became a symbol. We often heard from people who either hid it because they didn't want people to know they were reading it, or put it out there on their desk so that people to give a message, that it really did play a very symbolic role. But certainly, I just saw a documentary last night about the Women's Conference in Beijing, which was one of the first occasions when women from all over the world came together to put an agenda together of issues. And that was, I think, the first time that the international consensus about women's experience in all these countries was really brought forward. And Bella Abzug, of whom I am the biggest fan, actually did a book about her. It's an oral history about her life. And she just is, to me, the most admirable public figure. Although she probably wouldn't have made a great president.
You gave me the mic. Okay, sorry. Just first of all, quickly, I just want to relate. First of all, you mentioned the New York Times, the Help Wanted ads. I actually wrote a letter to the New York Times, I remember, it must have been the 1970s, 3 months before they abolished the separate ads. And the editor of the section called me, and he said, why did you write this letter? And I said, because I want to apply for some of the men's jobs, and I have friends who have been turned down. They said, well, it was with Help Wanted ads. He seemed totally unaware that there was a problem, and he said, I want names, dates, and places, you know, and whatever, whatever. And I finally said, okay, I'll get them and I'll write them to you. And he said, because, you know, we have no intention. You can write all the letters you want. We will never change that. Anyway, that was 3 months before. So, secondly, all the godmothers of the movement, are most of them are still around, thank goodness, but do you see any young, particular young people, maybe from the millennial, you know, Generation X generation, who will be the next leaders that you're identifying, who will take up the gauntlet?
I don't see leaders like ours. I don't see people who are politically committed and ready to, you know, go to the barricades. But there are a lot, we all see these young women, name again, what's her name, who had her own show, who's kind of chubby and, no, the other one. Lena Dunham, thank you. I mean, she's really out there challenging a lot of the prejudices against women. And in fact, she's just started an online magazine, and one of their features is that they have gotten women their age to interview their mothers about their abortion experience. So I think we may not see them in the style that we've gotten used to, but there's certainly women out there at the forefront who aren't going to take it anymore, I think.
Thank you for today's talk. I just wanted to give you a heads up. I was watching CBS News this morning. Maureen Dowd has written a lengthy article on the inequality in Hollywood, and I just want to give
right.
That's coming up this
right.
weekend.
Now that's a big issue.
Abortion was a huge issue for us and seems to be reemerging as a huge problem once again. Back in the day, I just wonder why it's never addressed as a socioeconomic problem which it really is more than a religious one, when it was illegal, I had it done legally. Because I could go to two psychiatrists who wrote I needed a therapeutic abortion, went to University Hospital, had it done there, and my insurance paid for it. When you think of the inequity that the poor people were not able to have what I had, it really is, it's just inequity.
Even just the 24-hour, 48-hour waiting period, what that does to a poor woman who has to be away from her job, who has to stay overnight because she's driven 500 miles, it is definitely an economic issue. But certainly the people who have been trying to educate the world on this subject always make the point that the economics are very much part of it, and even in other respects that in countries that are doing better economically, when a society begins to do better economically, the size of families go down because women are more committed to their larger experience and find ways to keep their family size small.
Is this on? Yeah, okay. Just a comment and a question. I also had an illegal abortion. Luckily for me, I guess you could say luckily, I was in New York here, and I just, this is before the law was passed, I assumed correctly, as it turned out, that if I went to Bellevue and said, this is what I need, they would give me an abortion. And that's exactly what happened, even though the law hadn't been passed yet. And I subsequently did work for NARAL and telephone calling, and that poster, the picture you mentioned of the woman on the floor, I think about it all the time. So I'm sure there are a lot of women who do. Now my comment is, going from shame to anger, do you think women are able to express anger more easily today than when I was a 25-year-old, let's say, when there was no such thing as getting angry in public, much less in private?
Well, a lot of the women who finally got there in our generation really had to learn how to do it. But the ones that have come after don't have that problem. And I think for us, when I write about women over 50, one of the big liberating things that has happened is that we don't care what people think, we care what we think. And I call it the fuck you 50s, because you don't need to be liked anymore. You know what you think and you want to stand up for it. And I think that this is a great resource, that we are still a great resource for social change as we get older.
I think abortion is a gigantic issue. But I think the other gigantic issues that we really have to focus on equally are equal pay for women, daycare so that they can go to work and have their children taken care of. I mean, I think these are really, really, really big issues that even when you get past the abortion stage are vital for families, you know, and I think that has to be just as gigantic a push.
I totally agree, and I think that this hurdle of this idea that American families have to figure out how to make it work one by one, that anything that calls for government action is somehow some kind of socialist plot. Every other country that has paid family leave also has childcare, paid childcare. France is, of course, the biggest example. I think the question is why? What is it that makes the American definition of family so restricted, so that it's the failure of the parents to figure things out that's causing the problem, rather than the failure of the society at large? I mean, when I hear these guys say, we have the best health care in the world. You just want to, what can you say? I mean, we have the worst. We're among, as I'm sure you know, the lowest ranks in health care. In maternal mortality, we're not the first. So we have this fantasy that you ought to be able to manage your family and balance life and work, or it's your fault. And it's back to the shame thing, I think. That's a current form of shame.